Hey everybody, Nathan Foulkes here, and I have a workshop coming up that I'd like to chat with you about for a few minutes. It's Launching Your Career in Animation Art and Entertainment Design, because things are very different today for art and entertainment students than when I went to school. Today, there are tremendous opportunities, but the competition to get those opportunities are extraordinary, and you have to have the ability to hit the ground running so that you're prepared to take advantage of those opportunities, which is what this workshop is going to be about. So let me share with you just a couple of experiences from my career so that we can discuss that. So when I went to school, I loved drawing and painting and picture making, and so I enrolled in an illustration program and focused my efforts primarily on drawing and painting, hoping to make a career as an illustrator. But it quickly and painfully became obvious that print illustration was dying and devolving into a style that was dark and macabre. Not bad, a lot of interesting, compelling imagery came out of that period. It's just that it wasn't a style that I was personally interested in working in. And to compound that, about halfway through my school experience, I went and saw the movie Jurassic Park. Now, in its time, Jurassic Park was the big grand special effects movie. It made back in 1993 $900 million worldwide. It was huge. Well, I really enjoyed the show. I really loved the idea of seeing dinosaurs brought to life and stomping around. Loved the spectacle of it. Except that when I came home from the movie, went back to my studio apartment, and looked at the artwork on my desk that I was doing, I felt about 2 inches tall, because it just looked dull and uninteresting compared to this spectacle that I had just seen. I don't mind telling you, I felt pretty depressed. Well, art school costs way too much money for you to waste your time moping around. So, you know, I pulled myself out of bed, dusted myself off, redoubled my efforts, and it became clear that if I was going to have fun in my career as an artist and make a living, I would have to go into entertainment art of some kind. I didn't know exactly how to do that, and so I continued to focus my efforts on the basics: drawing, painting, color, lighting, and design. And that was enough to get me an opportunity, because DreamWorks Studios was just starting up around the time that I got out of school, and they were willing to hire people who had core skills that they could train into what they needed for their first animated project, The Prince of Egypt. Well, I was surprised and as excited as anyone that just a couple of years after I had had that experience, you know, watching Jurassic Park and other movies and loving the spectacle of them and the largeness of them, but feeling very inadequate because of them, all of a sudden I had the opportunity to contribute to our grand epic production. Not only that, but I got to be taken under the wing of some really fantastic artists and mentors who trained me in where I could go with this. So I started learning about the production pipeline and what needed to be done to create that grand animated project that we hoped for and wanted to make. And so I'll show you some of the work that I did on the show. Here's one of the background paintings that was on the basis of the series of color keys that I did for the show. And so, for instance, this is one of the color key paintings. And what this is meant to do is to establish what a final scene should look like from the show. And so here is the final scene that it led to. This is a still frame capture out of the show. And so I went on to work on the project to be a small fish in a big pond, make my contribution, a color key that led to this background painting. And we had a tough deadline. This painting had to be turned around in a very short period of time. So three of us actually tackled it. The great background painter and stylist Barry Greenberg doing the background area, Donald Yatomi, our great background painter and currently working as a conceptual artist in games, doing the side temple, and myself doing the foreground element here. A few other examples of some of the work that I did on the show. And I actually got to bring some of my training into play, you know, going to school to be an illustrator. I got to do book covers for some of the children's books that followed up the show. And on the basis of that, I got to continue onto projects like The Road to El Dorado, set in ancient America, and initially beginning in Spain and then on the boat ride that led over to Mesoamerica, and then Spirit, Stallion of the Cimarron, which was fantastic because I've always had a love for landscape painting. And essentially on this project, we got to be Western landscape painters for a year and a half. And then we came to Sinbad, Legend of the Seven Seas. And here are some color key paintings for the show. Which brings us to Shark Tale, which was my first CG animated film, and I'm very proud to be a member of the generation of artists that made the transition and created the computer-generated animated film. And I have a real love for color and lighting and pattern, and so this was an exciting opportunity and an incredibly challenging opportunity for me as well. And so I could tell you war stories, and as a matter of fact, I will in the workshop. Also had the opportunity, once we went CG, to not only do conceptual art, but to do some work as a matte painter for this show and for others. And so I worked on several of the Shrek projects, doing a lot of conceptual artwork for the shows, some of which made it to the final screen, other ones not. That's just par for the course and how it goes. We also did a few Halloween specials, TV specials that are replayed every year, and so it was a real blast to kind of riff off of that traditional Halloween color and lighting. How to Train Your Dragon. This is a poster painted by Emil Maitev and myself for the marketing of How to Train Your Dragon, and we were so proud of that show. And so here's some of my artwork and location design for the show, very much inspired by our art director extraordinaire, Pierre Olivier Vincent, who established the tone and the look of the film. And so in the workshop that we have coming up, part of what we'll talk about is the collaboration that happens between members of the art department and the art direction, the production design, and the directing. So some color key sketches for How to Train Your Dragon. And originally the main character, Hiccup, he was going to be a redhead. And the decision was made partway through the process that it would be more appropriate for the story to tone down his look a little bit, and so he became a brunette. And so of course that meant, you know, throw some of the old stuff out, and we went back to the drawing board. And that's another thing that's par for the course, as you find your way on that razor thin line between what works and what ultimately doesn't work to make these animated films happen. And most recently on the big screen, The Legend of the Puss in Boots, and myself and Marcos Mateo were the first artists on the film. The fantastic layout artist and conceptual artist Marcos doing layout drawings here, and then me being the painter for the drawings, and we put together the beat board that was meant to be the first pass at illustrating the look for Puss in Boots. And then I went on to do the initial color script for the film, and then going to get some concept work. Here are some of the sketches that appear in the color script. Location design work for the film. Character development and how the characters work in the environments. An early look and styling for the Cat Cantina, this layout drawn by Henrik Tam, a good friend who I went through school with, and painted by myself. So some of this artwork is a collaboration, and some of it, you know, it gets to be exclusively your own ideas and your own paintings. This was a lot of fun to paint. This was a layout by our art director on Puss in Boots, Christian Schellewald, and then I got to take the layout sketch and turn it into a color illustration. And some lighting design. So these are lighting keys for the Puss in Boots follow-up, Puss in Boots and the Tres Diablos. And so my point is, when I went through school, there were some opportunities that might not exist today because I was taking on largely untrained and had some time to be taken under the wing of some great illustrators and animation artists. But as I said at the top, it's very much the opposite today. Today, you have to hit the ground running to beat the competition. And so my job for you in this workshop is to be that person who can show you where and how to focus your efforts so that you can meet and be prepared for those opportunities. And so I have had and have been given the opportunity to work on several feature films, with my primary residence being at DreamWorks, but also the opportunity to work with Blue Sky Studios, with Digital Domain, doing some teaching and consulting work for Blizzard Entertainment, THQ Studios, Big Fish Studios, Infinity Ward, and others, and to go through and learn the entire production pipeline in look development, color scripting, location design, prop design, color keys, lighting design, matte painting, all of the things that you have to understand, as well as thoughts about working with your art director and your production designer, and especially how to take all of these areas and topics and put them together in an effective portfolio that show that you're the right person for the job. Those are the topics that we are going to cover in the workshop so that you are prepared to launch your career in animation art and entertainment design. So I'd love to see you coming up on Saturday, July 28th, 2 to 7 p.m. And so you can contact our hosts, motivardi.org, to enroll. But even if you can't make it to the workshop, I want to wish you best of luck in your artistic endeavors.